each one of you tonight. Glad you came out and braved the rain. It's good to have the rain. But Becky was telling me this afternoon, she went through this weekend, put away all her winter stuff, and now got to pull it out again. But I'm glad you all were here tonight. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask His blessing on our time of worship together. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your grace, Your mercy, Your kindness, and the privilege that we have to be in Your house tonight. Lord, we're reminded of what the Scripture says. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And we are so glad to be here to praise Your name, Lord, and also to fellowship with the saints. We just love this opportunity that You've given us and count it as a grace gift, knowing, Lord, that not everybody enjoys this privilege around the world. Lord, we give You the honor and glory for everything that happens tonight and lift You up in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening. Let's stand as we sing our first hymn, hymn number 375, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. May we stand as we sing. Verse, that first verse we just sang, in case you were kind of dazed out there, says, 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Anyone want to share a promise that you have rested on this past week? Anyone want to share a promise of the Lord that you would like to say, I rested upon this one this week?
I know He walks with me every second of every day.
Amen. I saw a hand back there. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. Anyone else? He's our strength. Amen. Amen. So we can rest upon every promise. I encourage you this week to find a promise, whatever you may be facing, whatever you may be dealing with, and say, I'm going to rest upon this promise this week. Let's sing the second verse.
Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust His cleansing word, just in simple faith to plunge me in the healing, cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
And fellowship together and shake each other's hand.
Yeah, it's 6 on Sunday night, 7 on Wednesday. Yeah, I know.
sing that part again.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name.
Amen. You may be seated. For our offertory hymn this evening, it's hymn number, I said you can be seated, but I didn't look at the song. The song is Stand Up for Jesus. So we got to stand back up. We can't sing that one sitting down. So if you would, let's stand back up for our offertory hymn, Stand Up for Jesus. This will be our offertory hymn.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross.
Y'all done? Okay. All right, just thought, make sure there. If you got your Bibles, let's turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 this evening. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning in verse 12. And we're going to talk about the subject tonight in our series on basics for believers. We're going to talk about resisting temptation. Resisting temptation. Temptation and how to deal with it in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, that you may be able to bear it. Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your holy, inspired, and inerrant word. We thank you for the truth that is contained therein, that it is fully reliable, that it is sufficient. And Lord, we recognize that it is also necessary. We ask, Lord, that you would give us clarity and understanding, and that, Heavenly Father, that we would respond with joy to your word. In Jesus' name, amen. I was reading one time about how Eskimos hunt wolves, and a very interesting story about how Eskimos would hunt wolves. What they do is they would take a knife, a very, very sharp knife, and they would take the knife and they would dip it in blood and let the blood freeze, and then dip it in blood again, and let the blood freeze, and dip it in blood again until they created a thick blood popsicle on the blade of the knife. And then they would bury the knife with the handle down and the blade sticking up in the ground, and they would wait for a wolf to come along. And the wolf would begin to lick the blood off. And in his lust and greed and desire for the blood that he's licking and gobbling, the cold from the frozen blood would numb his tongue to the point that when he got down to the bottom, to the knife itself, he would actually begin to cut his own tongue, and the wolf would bleed to death. He would literally become a victim of his own greed, a victim of his own lusts, a victim of his own desires. And the truth is that the Bible teaches this, that Satan uses the same tactic to defeat God's children. He knows that he cannot destroy your soul. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you are eternally secure. Your destiny in heaven is sealed, it is assured. You cannot lose your salvation, but you can lose other things. You can lose your comfort. You can lose your peace. You can lose your joy. You can lose your assurance. And most importantly of all, you can lose your testimony and your ability to impact the world for Jesus Christ. And failing, destroying your soul, Satan desires nothing more than to neutralize you for the kingdom of God. That is his desire. And he will use our desires, our lusts, to drag us down to the point where we no longer have any impact for Christ. Temptation, however, can be overcome. It can't be avoided, but it can be overcome. And I believe that every believer needs and wants to know how they can turn temptation into triumph. When temptation arises, we usually respond to it in one of three different ways. The number one way that people respond to temptation in our world today, the most common way, is that they simply give in to it. That is the number one way to deal with temptation. Lost people, even Christians, will just give in to temptation because we live in a society that says, if it feels good, do it. We have that kind of mentality. And to be honest, most people live that way. They live as slaves to the desires of their flesh. They live really no different than animals, doing everything they can to gratify the flesh. Nearly all lost people, and even, as I said, many people who call themselves Christians, live that way. Then there are others who struggle against temptation, who fight temptation and the desires of their flesh, things that they know are wrong, things they know they should do wrong. The only problem is they're fighting it in their own strength and their own ability. They're not leaning upon the power that God has given us. Or they're not saved at all and therefore don't have access to the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and the power of God to overcome temptation. And they constantly fail because they just don't have the resources, or they're not availing themselves of the resources that Christ has given us in order to overcome temptation. They're like the little boy who snuck into the kitchen one evening, and he climbs up on the counter and he opens the cookie jar and he reaches in to get a cookie, and just as his hand is in the cookie jar, his mother walks in and asks him, "What are you doing?" And he says, "I'm fighting temptation." But he's failing. He's failing, and that's where they find themselves. And finally, there are those who overcome temptation through the power that Christ has given us. They turn temptation into triumph. And for many of us, that just sounds like wishful thinking. We wish we could do that. But it is possible. It is possible to live in victory, to have victory over temptation. But there are a few things that we need to know if we're going to do this. So let's think together tonight. Let's look at the scriptures and let's examine this question of how to resist temptation. And let's start by looking at who it is that is affected by temptation. And the answer to that is anybody who's a human being. All human beings are subject to temptation. Peter was tempted and he fell. King David was tempted and he fell to temptation. Even Jesus was tempted and yet was without sin. He was tempted but never sinned. All of us have been tempted. Every one of us is susceptible to temptation. But it is not sin to be tempted. Understand, there's a difference between temptation and actual sin. Sin happens when you surrender to temptation. Hebrews 4:15 says, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but in all points tempted as we are, yet," meaning Jesus, "he was without sin." Jesus was tempted, but he was without sin. Why? Because he never gave in to the temptation. In fact, Jesus was tempted more severely than any human being in the face of the earth, or history of the earth. Jesus suffered more temptation than you and I will ever see in our entire life. And the reason I know that is because he never gave in to it. See, temptation is kind of like water pressing against a dam. It grows and it grows and it grows. And as human beings, when temptation just gets to a certain point, we just collapse and give in to it. But Jesus, because he was not only man, but he was also fully God, never gave in to that temptation. And no matter how much pressure the temptation caused, no matter how severe the temptation got, he endured it and never gave in. Never gave in. He was tempted, and yet he did not sin. He did not sin. We, on the other hand, are prone to sin. Even as believers in Christ, even though we have a new nature, even though we've been born again, even though we are new creations, we do fall into sin from time to time. In fact, I would argue that it is a very dangerous thing to get the mentality that somehow you are without sin, or that you are immune to sin, or that you've been a Christian for so long that you cannot sin. That is a very dangerous way of thinking. Verse 12 says, "Therefore let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall." Proverbs verse 16, verse 8, chapter 16, verse 18 says, "Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall." When our pride tells us that we cannot fall, specifically in a particular area, and we all have an area where we see someone else fall and we say, "I would never do that. I would never fall into that temptation. I would never give in to that. That would never happen to me." You know what happens when you do that? When you say that, the moment you say that, the devil says, challenge accepted. Be careful. Be careful when you let pride tell you that you are immune to sin. So here's the question. Why doesn't God just destroy the devil and remove all attraction for sin? Well, why doesn't he do that? Well, first of all, we don't really need the devil to tempt us. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. We've got enough resources on our own to drag us aside without the devil. But secondly, even if God did remove all temptation, if that were to happen, you and I would lose the ability, the opportunity to become overcomers in Jesus Christ. We would lose the blessing of winning victories over temptation. We would also lose the opportunity to struggle against temptation and grow in our faith and in our resilience and have victory for Christ. So what is the source of temptation? Well, verse 13 says that all temptations are common. They're all common. That means that anything that you struggle with is not unusual. There's nothing new under the sun. Every one of us struggle with the same old run-of-the-mill garden variety temptations. We all get the same ones, and we all get the same temptations from the same sources. There are three sources for temptation. Remember, I told you just a moment ago that if God just destroyed the devil, just got rid of the devil altogether, we would still fall into temptation because he is not the only source of temptation. The first source of temptation that I want to talk to you about tonight is the world, the system of the world. In the Bible, the word world, when it speaks of the world, often the scripture is referring to the system, the order of this world. The Bible speaks of the system called the world, and it says that it is evil. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. James chapter 4, verse 4. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with the Father? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Folks, it is possible for believers to fall into lockstep with the system of the world. The world has its system of how things should be done. Lost people have a system for how they do things. And we run into this with our young people, but adults run into it as well. Well, they'll say, well, everybody does that. Everybody does it this way. That's just the way things are. Hey, it's 2017. Folks, the world may do things a certain way, but we don't follow the system of the world. We're different. We're different. Now, I'll give you an example pertinent right now. We're right in the middle of prom season. And I know I raised two daughters. And let me tell you, when you go out and you try to find a modest dress for a daughter to wear to the prom, folks, it's a losing battle. Because the world has a system. And everything is designed for the world's system. But we have a different view of beauty. We have a different view of what is appropriate. We have a different view of what is honorable. We're different people. We're different people. Romans 12:2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." See, we have a choice. We have a choice. We can be either a thermostat or a thermometer. You know what a thermostat does? A thermostat sets the temperature in the room. A thermometer just reflects it. Folks, we can be a thermostat to our community, a thermostat to our culture. We can help change the culture. or we can just be a thermometer and reflect everything that's going on around us. But if you're a thermometer, if you're just reflecting what's going on around you, I guarantee you one thing is true, you're not changing anything. You're not having any kind of impact in the world around you. We're called to be different. We're called to be different. So the first source of temptation for us is the world's system. But there's a second source of temptation, and that, folks, is the flesh. The flesh. When the Bible speaks of the flesh, it is often talking about our sinful nature, that nature that is born into every one of us. From the youngest child to the oldest adult, there is a bent to our nature that leans toward sin. We inherited it from our first father, Adam, and every one of us has acted on it. We are born to love sin. We are born to follow sin. And even after we are saved, when we receive a new nature, when we are transformed and made a new creation, we still have this old flesh that still is prone to certain desires and lusts and temptations and habits that we had in the past. And so we tend to be driven astray or drawn astray by these failings, by this old, unredeemed flesh. Which brings us to the final source of temptation, the devil. Folks, there is a devil. He is alive and well on planet Earth. And he is alive and well in the United States of America. And not only that, he has a whole lot of help. The Bible says that when the devil fell, that he took a third of the angels with him. And I guarantee every one of us will have some kind of encounter with a demonic force that will attempt to lead you astray. You may never encounter the devil himself personally. I doubt that any one of us will ever be important enough for him to take any interest in us, but one of his minions will. Every one of us will struggle with demonic influences, demonic forces that want to lead us astray, that want to destroy our witness for Christ. He loves to point saints in the wrong direction. He loves to accuse us of evil before the Father. Even his name, Satan, in the Old Testament in Hebrew, Satan means the accuser. He loves to accuse us. Folks, don't give him the satisfaction. Don't give him the satisfaction. So what is the seat of our temptation? What is the area that is prone to temptation? What part of us? Well, the first part of us is our soul or our spirit. Now, there are those who teach that your soul and your spirit are two separate things. I'm of the conviction that the soul and spirit are the same thing because the Bible tends to use soul and spirit interchangeably within the Scripture. The soul and the spirit, it is your the seat of your emotions, your mind, your will. It is the you that lives inside your body. And the world is the primary tempter of your soul, of your spirit. The world says to you, you need more. You can have more. You deserve more than you're getting today. The world appeals to our ego. It appeals to our pride. And the worldly person is the person who is given over to the pleasures of the world. In Genesis chapter 13, we see Lot. He's with Abraham, and his herdsmen get into a conflict with Abraham's herdsmen, and so Abraham says, we need to go our separate ways. And the Bible tells us that he tells Lot, pick which direction you want, any direction you want. And the Bible says that Lot looked. He looked, and he saw the plain where Sodom and Gomorrah was, that it was well watered, it was good for grazing. It was a beautiful place. He said, I want to live there. I want to live there. He was attracted by the lust of the eye. And then he gets down there to the plain, and the Bible says that he pitched his tents towards Sodom. He began to lean towards Sodom. He began to be attracted by the worldliness of Sodom, the worldly pleasures that were there and were available to him. And then the next time we see him, he has not only looked, he's not only leaned towards Sodom, he is actually living in Sodom. He is in the very gates of Sodom when the angels come to destroy the city. He is a leading citizen there. And then in the end, the Bible tells us that when Sodom is destroyed, he loses everything, including his wife. And in the end, winds up living in a cave with his daughters. He has nothing because he was attracted by the lusts of this world. The desires of this world, the things of this world attracted him. Satan attacks the soul and the spirit. But we see also our body is a source of temptation for us, or the seed of temptation. It is a tool that is used for temptation. And the flesh is still unredeemed, folks. One day we're going to have a resurrected body that is not subject to temptation. One day we'll have a resurrected body that is not prone to laziness or lust or overindulgence or sexual sin. All these are temptations of the flesh. You remember David, when he was in the palace. He should have been out at war with his generals, but instead he's staying behind in the palace, and he sees Bathsheba as she's bathing, and he is drawn aside by the lusts of the flesh. The flesh. And so he is tempted and he falls because of that. So how do we subdue temptation? How do we deal with the sources of temptation? How do we deal with the seed of temptation? How do we subdue temptation? Well, in verse 13, he says, God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. Folks, you have no excuse for falling into temptation. None whatsoever. Well, Pastor, you know, I'm only human. I can only endure so much. Yes, well, the Bible also promises that God will never allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able to endure with His help. See, that's the key right there, with His help. If you will avail yourself of the tools that He gives you, there is no temptation that has to drag you down. You fall into temptation because you choose to, because you refuse to avail yourself of the resources that God has given you. And those resources fall into three categories: flight, fight, and faith. To overcome the temptations of the flesh, what you need is flight. You need to flee the temptations of the flesh. 1 Corinthians 10:14. Flee idolatry. 1 Corinthians 6:18 says, flee fornication. 2 Timothy 2:22 says, flee youthful lusts. You beginning to see a pattern here? Run away from it. Put as much distance between you and that thing that tempts you as is humanly possible. The problem that we have today is not that we cannot resist the temptation, but that we want to get as close to it as we possibly can. We see the edge. We know we should get as far away as we can, but instead, we see how close we can get and not quite fall over. And I have people talk to me, they'll say, Pastor, well, you know, in this situation, you know, how much is too much? Where's the line at? My response is, don't worry about where the line is. Get as far from the line as you can. Put as much distance between you and the edge as you can. If there's a relationship that is causing you to fall into sin, cut off the relationship. If there's a resource that is causing you to fall into sin, get rid of that resource. There are a lot of people out there that need to pull the cable cord out of the wall and get rid of that box.
There are a lot of people out there that need to get rid of that thing that keeps dragging them down. I knew a lady one time in Louisville, Kentucky. She'd been an alcoholic for many years. And I was talking to her one time, and she said, Pastor, she said, one of the problems I have is that when I'm driving through town, I'll drive through the part of the town where there are rows. There are places in Louisville, Kentucky, you can drive through town, where there are roads, miles and miles of nothing but barns filled with barrels of bourbon. And you can drive there and it smells. I mean, it smells like you got an open bottle of bourbon under your nose while you're driving through there. She'll tell me, Pastor, when I drive through there, just the temptation, just I'm just so overcome. And I said, well, what are you doing over there? She said, well, I do have to go out of my way sometimes to go over there. I just like to drive, just like to smell it. Don't go there. Don't go there. Got a problem with gambling? Stay away from the track. Stay away from the casino. Put as much distance between you and the thing that drags you down as possible. Flee. Your first line of defense, flight. Flee from the things that threaten to drag you down. Proverbs 6:27. Can a man take fire into his bosom and his clothes not be burned? Can one walk on hot coals and his feet not be seared? So is he who goes into his neighbor's wife. Whoever touches her shall not be innocent. Joseph, when he was tempted by Potiphar's wife, do you remember what happened with him? She tries to seduce him. Potiphar's wife tries to seduce him. And instead of hanging around and enjoying the flattery, the Bible says he fled. She grabbed his clothing to try to keep him. He slips out of his clothing and runs out naked rather than be there. Run. Flee from temptation. Be like Joseph. Put some distance between you and that thing that tempts you. Flight is our first line of defense. But then, to overcome the world, sometimes what we need is faith. We need faith. Faith that Jesus will take care of us. Faith that Jesus and His commands are righteous and good and all that we really need. Folks, faith will help us break the attachment to the things of this world. Because if you love the world, the Bible says you don't love God. 1 John 2:15, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Don't become so enamored with the things of the world that you get sucked into the system of how the world works. There are a lot of people out there that they love their job so much that they're willing to compromise their morals, they're willing to compromise their ethics, they're willing to compromise their ability to witness for Jesus Christ because, we do a few things at work that are a little shady, but I love my job. There are people who fall in love with the world. I've got this girlfriend, I love her. I know we shouldn't be sleeping together, but it's just the way the world is, and I love my girlfriend. Don't fall in love with the world. You need to fall in love with Jesus. 1 John 5:4, for whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. You know why he says that? You know why he says faith overcomes the world? Because if you really want victory over the world, then the love of Jesus is going to be more important to you than the love of the world. And if you love Jesus, whom you can't see, more than the world, which you can see, that takes faith. Faith. Faith helps you overcome the world. And finally, if you're going to overcome the devil, you need to fight him. You need to fight him tooth and nail. And if you stand up to him, the Bible says in James 4:7, that he will flee. If you will stand up to the devil, if you will fight him, if you will oppose him, he will flee. Now, I'm going to warn you right now, the devil's not scared of you. He's not scared of you at all. The lowest minion of hell, the lowest angel, a fallen angel, the lowest demon from hell, folks, has no terror of you. Because you're weak. You're nothing. You know what they're afraid of? The Word of God. They're afraid of Jesus Christ. When Jesus was in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4, and Satan comes to him and begins to tempt him, the devil begins to tempt him, what did he fight the devil with? Scriptures. He quoted Scripture over and over. The Bible says eventually the devil departed from him. If you'll do the same thing, the devil will depart from you as well. You know the problem we have? The Bible says that the Scripture is a two-edged sword. It is your tool for fighting the devil. It is your weapon for fighting the devil. The problem is that we as Christians go into battle against the devil with John 3:16 and Jesus wept and that's about it. We got a weapon about that long to fight with. We need to start filling our hearts and our minds with Scripture. We need to start committing it to memory. Thy word hath I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. So we need to make sure we have a bigger weapon so we can fight the devil so that he will depart from us. Now, I don't know what temptations you're dealing with in your life. Because quite honestly, every one of us is prone to different kinds of temptations. The things that tempt me may not tempt you. I've said this before. I can take a cart to the grocery store and I can go down the beer aisle, the wine aisle, liquor. None of that appeals to me at all. It just doesn't call to me a bit. But as I've said before, if I turn down the Krispy Kreme aisle, that's a different thing altogether. We've all got whatever that thing is to you that tempts you. Maybe it is... Maybe it's sexual sin. Maybe it is greed. Maybe it's gluttony. Maybe it's laziness. Whatever that thing is that you are prone to, you can overcome it. Every one of us fights with something. If you're breathing, you're battling. Every one of us. And your greatest asset, your greatest resource in fighting temptation is a close walk with Jesus Christ and memory of His Word, committing His Word to memory. My counsel to you tonight is that you bring your need to Christ, that you draw close to Him so that He will draw close to you, that you begin committing God's Word to memory so that you can use it when you need it. That you identify those things that the Holy Spirit is witnessing to you that you need to deal with right now, and you begin to flee from it. That you have enough faith to say, you know, I'm not going to do things the way the world does it. I'm going to do things differently from the world. If the world doesn't like it, well, that's the world's problem. But be different. Flee, fight, and have faith. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your grace and mercy. We thank You for Your kindness and for Your help in temptation. Lord, every one of us here deals with something. We ask, Lord, that You would convict us tonight, that we might repent of that thing, and that You might give us the tools that we need to fight those battles. Lord, we pray that none of us would give up, that none of us would give in, but Heavenly Father, that we would continue to battle against temptation. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.